congratulations to all of the former directors, and thank you for all your heartwarming words and for the speeches that you have made. It is now time to listen to the last conversation. We are approaching to the final part of this day. So we close our anniversary ceremony with a talk by Erio Tosatti, ICTP scientific consultant, and Agnese Bissi, ICTP research scientist. So please take a seat. So I leave you to it. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to be here today with Erio Tosatti, who knows the ICTP since several years. So today is going to give us a unique point of view on the Institute, and we'll just say even more stories from what the one we had today.
Thank you, Agnese. It will be a very personal and I hope short point of view about this wonderful journey that ICTP has taken around the world in the last 60 years. So as a senior sort of person, I have to go through some of the history. And on the left here, you can see the inception of ICTP in 1960. You watch this picture. There are two scientists that are still around in this picture. And one of them is Luciano Bertocchi here, to whom we pay our respect and salute. And the other is Daniele Amati, who I hope is around in the picture. And he's out there, right. Luciano has been serving, as has been now said, as deputy director and acting director, and a lot of driving force in the ICTP. Daniele Amati is one of the most important directors in CISA nearby, but also flying together with the ICTP all the time, and with Miguel Virasoro in particular. We owe him a lot in this community. Right. So in this picture here on the right, you can see one of the first colleges. Maybe it is the plasma colleges that Dr. Galvao was referring to. Maybe you're even in the picture. I did not look. You can see this is one of the very first events. I'm not in there. It was not in my field. But you can see the force that comes out of this picture. They just created this thing. Abdus Salam, to whom we owe, I mean, infinitely much, and Paolo Budinic also, and all the people around there who were giving their support to this thing. This was the earliest place in Piazza Oberdan, and it's really something, a remarkable picture. There is a series of these pictures, and I love them all the time.
Yeah, so as you mentioned, of course, Abdus Salam played a major role in establishing ICTP, but here in Trieste, Paolo Budinic was crucial. Actually, this room is dedicated to him. Can you comment on the role he played for ICTP?
Yes, of course. Without Abdus Salam, his monumental intelligence and genius and also humanistic talent, I mean, he was, as one would say, an intellectual of the real strongest kind. Without him, nothing would have happened. But without the other person, Paolo Budinic, who was a local person and a builder, but a very, very shrewd navigator, at the same time very intellectual, a rare combination of two qualities in the same person, and a rare coupling of himself with Salam, they could not be more different, the two people. And how they could fly together is really a wonderful sort of event, an event that would not be easy to replicate other places. Paolo Budinic, as a matter of fact, went on to create other institutions. So you created CISA, where I belong. He also invented and played with other ideas. In 1977, I was in Stanford. Paolo Budinic sent somebody to Stanford to see how to create, in the Bay Area, how to create in Trieste a research area. So he was investigating the possibility to create here in a research area that did not exist. Of course, it's not an easy thing to to improvise, but it shows what was on his mind all the time. And other things like the synchrotron that was really then created by Fonda and others, and the ICGEB, which is seconded. So there was a lot of things that came after the ICTP. The ICTP proved that something could be done. This has been said before today. And once you prove that something can be done, other things can be built under that tint. And that's really what made a lot of difference. And we owe both Abdus Salam, of course, but Paolo Budin is a monument that should be taller than the Eiffel Tower, ideally, right? Maybe something will be done later on by the local community. They should recognize they changed the face of the city.
Thank you. So as we already heard this morning, ICTP was started during the Cold War and was one of the only places where scientists from beyond the Iron Curtain could meet in those years. How did you feel to be in a place like that where you could see all these scientists?
Yes, as has been said repeatedly, ICTP was created in a world that was very different from today. And there were countries that were absolutely locked and impossible to communicate. And one of them was the Soviet Union, and this was a place where people from the Soviet Union could come. I think we have a picture, one of many, E.M. Lifshitz. We at the time did not even know if Lifshitz really existed, because we only saw it on the paper. Do they really actually exist? And we came to meet them and to appreciate them and eventually, of course, the politics was driving the game. But this was the first place where people could tunnel. They could tunnel through this barrier, which was impossible to pass in other ways. That was one example. And the other example was China. China was
We see here in the picture, 1979, there was the first delegation who visited ICTP.
Right.
You were there also.
So. Yes, I happened to be here, and it so happened that the first Chinese delegation was of condensed matter people, and I was in condensed matter, so we organized things together, and to organize something with Wang Kun, Kun Huang of Born and Huang, to me, not even 30 years old or something like that, was really an incredible thing to do. And here you can see Wang Kun is the second on the right, and next to him is Professor Lung Chi Wei. His daughter, I think, still lives in Trieste. This was the first delegation of Chinese following this kind of opening. We got a lot of contacts with Chinese, and I should thank here Professor Yu Lu, who came here and served on the condensed matter group for 15, 20 years. And he really brought us a lot of Chinese people, students in particular. And many of these students went back to China, and some of them have made an immense career. Professor Gun Xingao, who was our student and postdoc, is now an academician in Fudan. And there are other examples like him. So this tunneling from the Soviet Union and tunneling from China was a wonderful thing to watch. Of course, now there is no need for tunneling, but these things have roots in the past and roots in the ICTP.
So over the years, as already mentioned by Atish this morning, ICTP has hosted nearly 200,000 visits from scientists from around 180 countries. Here we see a map, and it's quite impressive to see how the map fills in. So can you comment on that?
The comment is that I feel that my family has grown more than I expected. With these 200,000 people around the world, there are brothers and sisters. And they represent the mark that ICTP left in the world, but they also represent the mark that the world made on ICTP on our hearts. Speaking of heart, I want to quote an anecdote which moved me very much. I was somewhere in some airport, maybe it was in Mexico, I don't know where I was, and somebody approaches me smiling and say, you have been at ICTP. He was pointing at my T-shirt. So out of the blue, somebody had recognized the ICTP had been here somehow. If you go around the world, there are many cases, I think, like this. This is really something that moves you.
So we see here is the two nice pictures. So from the very beginning, ICTP was able to attract a very high-level scientists, certainly also thanks to Abdus Salam. We see him, a picture of him when in 1979 was awarded the Nobel Prize together with Glasch and Weinberg for the theory of electroweak unification. And also we see, here is only Kim, but we'll see later on a picture also of Carlo Rubbia, but let's start with commenting the excellence that came to ICTP.
Well, I mean, it was obvious that with all the advances that Salam and his collaborators had done, this was going to be a very strong candidate. It was a fantastic event when it actually happened. Some of us here may still remember it, how it was. It was not only very important scientifically, it was very emotional because it was felt that with this Nobel Prize, in theory, unifying electroweak theory, and then with the experimental follow-up that in CERN, in Rubbia's group, where I had been a summer student, by the way, in 1966, they actually discovered the bosons that were communicating the weak force. This double achievement was absolutely important scientifically, but it was also extremely important for establishing the fact that ICTP and the function of ICTP and the visibility of ICTP was getting ever stronger.
Yeah, so here we made already, there was several achievements for ICTP, and these achievements came again after this also Nobel Prize by Rubbia. And we see here other achievements that have been made in-house and not really in-house. Yes. Can you comment on that, on what
yes.
we see now?
Of course, I cannot resist as a condensed matter person to point out some of the achievement in condensed matter. There would be so many to speak of in other areas, in field theory, in many other places. The achievement in quantum information, quantum, have been done, and they're still going on in the group. Those that the others that maybe are worth mentioning are things that have done here in the house, not exactly by people who were personnel of ICTP, as a matter of fact. ICTP is an umbrella, and under the umbrella it spreads out, and there are people that work here some of the time, the people in other institutions associated with ICTP, there are people outside that come and go. There is all sort of mixing in this soup, but this soup is a fertile soup that produces a good thing. Roberto Carr and Michele Parinello were at the time either sister university, a mixture of the two. Roberto was a senior postdoc and Michele was an associate professor. They worked in this building, actually, in one of the rooms at this level, with a small computer had been able to buy at the time. It was called Gould, and it was failing most of the time, but when it would work, it was enough for them to do something. Working at night, by the way, because during the day it was busy with other people, they invented something which they would not have invented had I been here. Luckily, I was at IBM Rishlikon, and so out of the way, and so they could do it, and they did something which is now widespread all over the world. You see here in this picture the molecules of water dancing around because of thermal agitation. This is a picture that everybody sort of knows of today, but 40 years ago it was a miracle. Nobody could think of this kind of, I'm sorry to use the word, pornography for physicists. They're looking at how exactly things happen at the microscopic level. They invented this, and this is now very widespread all over the world. The other thing that was created here, inside which these codes now that do Carparinello simulation, is Quantum Espresso, of which Sandro Scandolo here is one of the founding fathers, so to speak. And this, again, is something that is now widespread all over the world. People that need to do a calculation, they sit down and they use this code. Somebody has to tell them what to do with it and why to do it and whatever, but you have to have all this gigantic work and it's free, it's open source, something you don't have to pay for, you don't have to ask for using it. It's your responsibility if you do stupid things with it, but it is something very useful. And Quantum Espresso is something to which the ICTP and the community and the CISA and Stefano Baroni and Sandro Scandolo and many, many other people actually contributed here. I need not add too much about climate because so much has been said, but it is obvious that besides the wars, besides the complication, besides the energy shortage, besides everything you want, that of climate is a genuine emergency that we're not going to get rid of that easily. So I think it is a must for our community to worry about it. And it has been shown now by Erica Koppel and all the other people here who have talked about how strongly we endeavor in this thing. A word about Filippo Giorgi, who and Franco Molteni, by the way, who might be in the audience, who actually started off this activity under various directors. I think it might have been Miguel Virasoro who started this field, this area, and I think this is extremely important. The IPCC, by the way, recognized this with in the Nobel Peace Prize in 2008. But independently of that, this is something that people here had the foresight to move into when it was necessary.
Thank you. Now we see you on the screen, so you has already been discussed a few minutes ago. You were an acting director of ICTP between 2002 and 2003. How would you describe your experience?
Okay, maybe I should share this discussion with Luciano Bertocchi, who served as a deputy director and an acting director for longer than myself. But if I have to speak for myself, I would say this was it's a personal reflection. It was both very exciting and consuming. It's exciting because for the first time you enter I'm from Modena originally. You enter a Ferrari and you realize that driving a racing car is not the same thing as watching it. It's actually much more exciting. It is also much harder. And it is very hard if you don't have a driver's license. A research physicist is not an administrator by birth. And nobody proves that fact more than myself. I'm very disorganized, so to administer something is a very heavy enterprise. It is also a pleasant enterprise, however, because of the collaboration of the staff, the collaboration of colleagues, this feeling of flying together towards, I mean, like a flock, not those of Parisi, but a flock of birds of going together somewhere. It's a wonderful feeling. I sang in a choir with Pavarotti in Modena in my times, and it had a similar feeling. If you sing in a choir and you fly to, I'm sorry to use these personal terms, but it was very exciting. At the same time, I could not wait to get out of it. because if you direct something and you have a heart in the place where I have it, any small thing that does not work actually hangs on you, is something that drags on your heart. And there are always a lot of things that do not work. And as a result, I did it with all my heart. I was very lucky. We had a good budget at the time because Miguel Virasoro, the Italian government, Miguel Virasoro and Nicola Cabibbo had done a very good job, and they left us with a substantial amount of endowment. So much that we could start computational physics. The only physics that had been done here before was paper and pencil. With all the respect for paper and pencil, and without abandoning it at all, but computation, as many people have said, Atish in the first place, this third leg, the third leg is essential. And it was a good time to start it, and we were lucky to have the right people that could do it.
So, as you mentioned, you changed your work essentially because you were interested to move from science to and research to thinking about ICTP as an infrastructure. So, how did your point of view on ICTP change at that point?
Yeah, having said this, this is like military service. Everybody should be administered for a while to learn how, what life is like. When I came here and I watched these other activities being proposed, the diploma course, other things, I said, what is that? I mean, this is not hard science. Why should we do it? We have to do the really top science in the world, otherwise... when I started wearing the shoes of a part-time administrator, things changed around. I realized how damn important it was to have these other things, how wrong had I been, how limited my view had been, and I'm sure it will continue to be wrong in the future. But at that time, this put me right. And the diploma course and the masters and the associates and many other things that the ICTP does are absolutely essential. And the many people that came out, like Estelle Inak here and others that came out of this cycle, prove are testimonials to the fact that this is so important for ICTP.
Another thing that we see is the library. So.
That's really a personal personal memory. If I have to think back, where was I most of the time in the ICTP? I was most of the time in the library because there was no electronic thing, there was no nothing. And this is true not just for myself. It's true for many people that came here. Some people came here when there was no activities whatsoever. Why did they come here? Well, they could go to the library. And the library was full of books, full of journals. As someone said, they were burning literally all the copying machine and going home having had so much carbon particles in their lungs because of that. There was also something I have to say. I apologize again for this dubious statement, but people were stealing books. As a director, the librarians came to complain to me that books were being stolen. I said, well, if they are stolen, it means they're needed. They're needed. We are not a church, but if we were in a church and they would steal the Bibles, it would mean that they want to take them home. And it means that they don't have one at home. They need it. Leave it. Buy more copies of the damn books that are... This is not an encouragement for people to do it.
Nowadays we have electronic books, so there is no need. So
mathematicians still go for paper books.
Okay, yes. Here we are. So we are 60 years later than the starting of ICTP. So we see a very nice video with a drone. So what do you think are the three main achievements of ICTP?
It would be difficult to choose only three, and I think there are so many that ICTP has done. But what excites me more is what ICTP is able to do and will do in the future if we get the resources to do it. And this is really a moment to think about getting more people involved with our mission that is absolutely sacrosanct. If it comes to myself, I think I'm very grateful to have been around personally, in particular for being able to do something that Salam and Budinic actually sort of said and did all the time, that is to be able to do half of the work for myself and half of the work for others. I would not have come here without the possibility to do this. And I think the community that is here is actually here because most people share the same view. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Erio. Thank you all.